My name's Eric Bennett. I'm a Puyallup Tribal member. We're out in Colvos Pass, which is Area 11. We're just north of Gig Harbor, in between Gig Harbor and Point Richmond, the Alala area. We're exercising our treaty rights as far as drift gillnet's concerned. We're out here with the bow picker. The season's winding down. You know, what we have in this particular area is we have an abundance of sea lions. We come out here and try to take care of and provide for our families. I've been fishing since I was 10 years old, and I'm 49 years old now. I've been out on the water a long time, and I've watched the sea lion population grow. It's really discouraging. I don't know if you got it on film or not, but before we even finish putting our net in the water, the sea lions show up. It's very discouraging. They ravage our net, rip holes in our gear, take our fish. I appreciate and respect all creatures of the water. You know, that's how I was raised like that. At the same time, there is an overpopulation of sea lions in our particular area. There used to be pods of orca whales that would come down, and they were seal eaters. You know, those pods very rarely come down to our area anymore. From my understanding, being on the Tribes Fish Commission, that the Puget Sound region can support approximately 7,000 sea lions. Their numbers are increased to a point where the ecosystem can't support them anymore. I mean, there's, I believe, 14,000 sea lions in the Puget Sound region. We have a lot of concerns about that, not only us as, indigenous people. Our culture is based on the water, you know, here at Puyallup. The water provides for us, you know, and we're grateful for that. You know, when it gets to the point where we are responsible for escapement of fish, us as tribal people are at the end of the food chain, so to speak. There's a lot of burden on us as tribes to make sure that these escapements get back to their habitat. Habitat or hatcheries, we have wild stock issues where we're protecting wild salmon and trying to increase their production and escapement, trying to build these runs. Now, we have a hard time doing that. Particularly, some areas are probably hit harder than us, but you know, when you have sea lions that are sitting out at the mouth of the river, picking fish up, wiping out runs, it becomes a serious problem.
Oh, two of them.
And when we have this many sea lions and seals in our particular area, when those orcas come down, the pods come down, the food isn't here that they need to survive. So there's a imbalance in the ecosystem that needs to be addressed. I mean, we have NOAA that, yes, at one time the sea lions were and seals were on the endangered species list and still are. I think they need to reevaluate that situation and look at not only protecting the orca whales but protecting our fish resource. And like anything else, like with elk and deer, if the herd gets too big, they have an opening and they go in and they thin it out. I can sympathize with the people that are out to protect the environment, you know, as far as like Greenpeace and other organizations. You know, they have a very just cause that they're trying to support. You know, at the same time, you have to look at when it gets too far and you do revive a certain species, then you have to look at what the imbalance is going to do to the ecosystem. So there's there's two different ways to look at it. Yes, we want to protect and make sure that these different species survive, but at the same time, is it at the risk and at the cost of other species?
It's really discouraging when you see the sea lions because you know you're not going to have any fish. Well, I've been told a few different stories about how many they eat a day, but I've watched two sea lions pick 100 fish out of my net because I counted the fish they took. I would say they probably can eat 40 fish a day easy, you know. And when you got 14,000 of them in the Puget Sound, that's an awful lot of fish. And all the sea lions follow the fish, of course, and so they all end up down here in South Puget Sound. Earlier in the year, we have more success with our fishing because there's more of them up north. But once all the northern fisheries are done, then we have the whole population down here in the South Sound. So it's basically a waste of time for me to even come out and go fishing, you know. All I hope for is that I can get a few fish to put in the freezer so that I can have fish when fishing is done. Because, shoot, we're native people, we like our fish. And that's one of our main subsistence that we eat. My 2-year-old, she can knock out a whole side of smoked salmon herself. And when I go crabbing, she'll sit there right when we're cooking them and eat 2 or 3 crab. She's only 2 years old. So, you know, I have 4 kids at home. So for me to put away fish and smoke fish and all that, you know, it's a lot of work, but boy, it sure is a pleasure to see the smile on their face when they're just grubbing out on our fish and our crab, and that's what it's all about, you know. Back in the 60s, when I was at the Puyallup fish camp when I was a kid, you know, they used to tell us, you know, this is all about you. You guys are our future, and we have to make sure that we protect your future as far as tribal members. And you know, and that goes on, you know. Now I feel that's my job to ensure that our children, our grandchildren, our great-grandchildren have the opportunity to come out here and do what we do as South Sound tribal natives, you know, carry on what our elders carried on for us, and teach them respect for the water. You know, it's very important that we're always in the public eye, you know, as far as being tribal members. You know, they're always saying, well, look at the natives, you know, and we have to represent ourselves accordingly, you know, and take care of our habitats, you know. That's a big thing with our fish. You know, we have to get wild stock back to creeks, you know, that really can't support the number of fish that needs to go there, because there's not the habitat, you know, with the developers and the city and local governments. They sign off these building permits that endanger our habitat, especially up in our upper creeks, you know, in our river system. And I think it's really important that the federal government needs to step in and enforce the habitat laws. You know, it gets frustrating to me, and I feel really passionate about our fisheries, our shellfish. You know, I remember my grandma used to take me clam digging out on Alki Beach. Not the sandy part. She would take me around the corner to the rocky part. And I said, Grandma, nobody else is digging here. It's too rocky. She'd tell me exactly. That's why there's more clams here, you know. And we'd always dig in the rocks, and we'd get our bucket of clams, and I look then. I didn't really like it because it was hard work, you know. But I look back, and she was pretty smart, you know. And I miss those days, you know. I miss my Kaya, and you know, I'm really glad for the times that I got to spend with her when I was a kid. You know, she taught me some really important things, you know, as I was growing up, just a youngster. And you know, now I can pass those same things on to my children and my grandchildren. You know, I have 4 kids at home, and I have 5 grandchildren and one on the way. You know, I may not look like an old guy, but, you know, I got, hey, now, anyway.